Nicolaus Copernicus was a devout Catholic, a church canon who swore a life of celibacy. Yet here he was, standing before his superior, forced to defend himself against a scandal. A woman had spent the night in his house. He insisted she was his housekeeper, but whispers spread. That controversy paled in comparison to the scandal his scientific ideas caused. He declared that the Earth was not the center of the universe, it was the sun, shattering 1,000 years of belief. In many ways, it seemed unlikely that he would change the world. He started university later than his peers and lingered in the halls of academia for 12 years without distinction. He was not a professional astronomer. He didn't have an observatory or any fancy instruments. This was a century before the telescope existed. Copernicus was born in 1473 in the trading city of Torun, then part of Royal Prussia, today in northern Poland. He came from a family of prosperous merchants, and he lived comfortably, surrounded by the intellectual ideas moving across Europe, which had recovered from the Black Death that wiped out as much as 50% of the continent's population. As a boy, he showed no signs of obvious brilliance. He wasn't a child prodigy and didn't appear mathematically inclined. After his father died when he was young, his uncle, a rising churchman, decided his nephew should get a good education and sent him to the University of Kraków, which was unusually strong in astronomy and astrology. He was nearly 19 years old, considered late to start university by the standards of the time. He dove into Regio Montanus, who exposed growing cracks in the prevailing belief that the Earth was at the center of the universe, a belief that had dominated for over 1,000 years, ever since Ptolemy formalized his Earth-centric model around 150 CE. But it wasn't until Copernicus that someone dared to break it entirely. After Kraków, he moved from city to city in Italy, absorbing astrology and astronomy, and eventually earning a doctorate in canon law at the age of 30. Then he did something strange for a man who just tasted Europe's intellectual life. He returned home, back to the remote church lands of Poland. But the isolation was a gift because he had the freedom to think in silence. It was here on the edge of the Baltic Sea that the most revolutionary idea in science would begin to take shape. It was in Frombork, beside his house outside the cathedral walls, that Copernicus observed the open sky. He didn't have an observatory, and the telescope hadn't yet been invented. He used simple geometric instruments that measured angles but never magnified a single star. Sometime between 1503 and 1513, he reached a conclusion about the universe that would upend the universe. The Earth was not the center of everything. The sun was. The Earth rotated daily on its axis, the moon orbited the Earth alone, and the universe is vastly larger than previously imagined. Copernicus recorded his ideas in a manuscript just 6 or 7 pages long, which he circulated privately among a small group of scholars. Historians would later call it the Commentariolis, or Little Commentary. Yet he withheld proof, explaining, "I have thought it well, for the sake of brevity, to omit from the sketch the mathematical demonstrations, reserving these for my larger work." That larger work would not appear for nearly 30 years. Though Copernicus appeared confident in his theory, insisting, "My explanation is the truer," he feared being wrong. His model contradicted the authority of Aristotle and Ptolemy, and his own reputation was already fragile. By the 1530s, he was reprimanded by church authorities for allegedly living with Anna Schilling, a well-educated woman from the Polish city of Gdansk. Officially, she was described as his housekeeper. Privately, she was widely thought to be his mistress. At a moment when Protestant reformers accused Catholic clergy of corruption, Copernicus could not afford a scandal. Martin Luther, founder of Lutheranism, the main Protestant movement, scoffed when he heard Copernicus's claim that the Earth was the one in motion. This would be as if somebody were riding on a cart or in a ship and imagined that he was standing still while the Earth and the trees were moving. Copernicus was deeply religious and never set out to challenge scripture. He just wanted to better understand the way of the heavens. But at a time when his moral authority was in question, it was no longer clear whether his life's work would ever be published. What Copernicus really did was change how people thought. That kind of thinking doesn't come from memorizing facts, but from building intuition. That's what I love about Brilliant, a website and app where you get hands-on with concepts until they click. If you've ever felt learning math was confusing and hard, Brilliant helps you develop the intuition and problem-solving skills to figure things out on your own, from algebra all the way to college-level calculus. One course I really love is Scientific Thinking, which teaches you to think like an engineer by solving puzzles so you truly understand concepts. If you'd like to start off 2026 by building healthy habits and improving your skills, it's a great time to learn with Brilliant. You can try Brilliant free for 30 days at brilliant.org/newsthink. The link is in the description, or by scanning the QR code on your screen. And if you decide to continue, you'll also get 20% off an annual premium subscription with unlimited access to everything on Brilliant. Copernicus had no idea if his work would be published. And then, unexpectedly, someone arrived who changed everything. Rheticus was a young, rising mathematician who made his way to Nuremberg, the great German hub of astronomy, astrology, and printing, where ideas were turned into books. He heard rumors of an aging canon who had quietly reimagined the universe and knew he had to meet him. So in May 1539, Rheticus, a Lutheran, set out for Frombork, deep in Catholic territory, crossing dangerous lines to meet Copernicus in person. He was astonished that Copernicus had developed his revolutionary system using only primitive instruments. His observatory was nothing more than a modest open platform by a hill near the cathedral. When Rheticus asked about the long-rumored larger manuscript, Copernicus showed it to him. Rheticus immediately grasped its magnitude. He knew this work could not remain hidden and urged Copernicus to let him introduce his idea to the world. With Copernicus's permission, Rheticus wrote a teaser to announce that the sun was at the center of the universe. To ease people in, the Narratio Prima, or First Report, respected tradition by honoring God and tipping a hat to ancient giants Aristotle and Ptolemy. But then it exposed the cracks in Ptolemy's geocentric model. Ptolemy had placed the Earth at the center of the universe with planets moving in perfect, uniform circles. But planets didn't behave that way. When astronomers watched Mars, it sped up, slowed down, even looped backward in the sky. To make the math work while keeping Earth still, Ptolemy introduced the equant, an invisible point in space from which motion only appeared smooth. But Copernicus hated it. He saw it as a clumsy hack. Instead of asking, "How do I fix Mars?" Copernicus asked, "What if the problem isn't Mars, but Earth?" So he moved Earth and placed the sun at the center. Copernicus wasn't fully correct. He believed planets moved in perfect circles at constant speeds. We now know they're actually ellipses with varying speeds. In Nuremberg, the powerful publisher Johannes Petraeus began lobbying hard for Copernicus's full manuscript. Between 1540 and 1541, Copernicus revised his work relentlessly, correcting, tightening, refining. In 1543, on the revolutions of the heavenly spheres finally went to press. Copernicus dedicated it to Pope Paul III and admitted his hesitation. "The fear of being hooted off the stage drove me to almost abandon a work already undertaken." The dedication helped shield the book from immediate suspicion, especially as Lutherans had mocked heliocentrism before the book even appeared. But the book didn't appear the way Copernicus intended. There was controversy. Rheticus had left publication in the hands of Lutheran preacher and theologian Andreas Osiander, who slipped in an anonymous preface claiming heliocentrism was only a mathematical hypothesis, not a description of reality. Copernicus couldn't fight back because he had suffered a debilitating stroke in December 1542. The general public barely noticed On the Revolutions of the Heavenly Spheres. It was meant for elite mathematicians, dense with tables, geometry, and calculation. But among astronomers, its meaning was unmistakable. The universe would never be viewed the same way again. Copernicus already knew from the publication of Rheticus's teaser that introduced his idea that Europe was paying attention. But he did not live long enough to see the impact of his life's work. He spent his final months in Frombork, isolated, enduring a harsh Baltic winter. Copernicus died on May 24, 1543, at the age of 70. He was buried inside Frombork Cathedral. A long tradition says the book was placed in his hands as he lay dying. As his friend Bishop Tiedemann Giza said, he saw his treatise only at his last breath on his dying day. His book didn't flip the world overnight. The idea that the Earth moves took decades to digest, and it needed others to carry it forward. Johannes Kepler became the first major astronomer to fully embrace Copernicus' moving Earth and showed planets moved in ellipses rather than perfect circles. Galileo Galilei's telescopic observations proved the Earth orbits around the Sun. The controversy exploded and he was tried in 1633 and sentenced to house arrest. Isaac Newton revealed planets moved around the Sun because of gravity, and Einstein later redefined gravity not as a force pulling at a distance, but as the curvature of space-time. Copernicus didn't live to see the consequences of his work, but he asked the right questions, and in doing so, he changed how we see the universe.
Thanks for watching. For Newsthink, I'm Cindy Pom.